right of privacy, an inherent right, be unequivocally a fundamental right, the old order changeth, yielding place to new. India, rejoice! You now have a fundamental right to privacy guaranteed by the Constitution. In a unanimous decision, a 9-judge constitutional bench upheld the right to privacy, subject to specified restrictions.
In an epic landmark ruling, the 9 judges of the Supreme Court have gone on to rewrite and redefine certain constitutional provisions. Today, they have upheld right to privacy as being integral to Article 21 and Part 3 of the Constitution.
The judgment will have a direct impact on every individual citizen, including how government can use your Aadhaar details. But the biggest discussion point that emerged from the verdict was the apex court's stand on Section 377, which criminalizes gay sex. The court in its judgment clearly saying that invasion of a fundamental right is not tolerable when it means that a few persons are subject to hostile treatment. The judgment goes on to note that the Constitution has evolved and must continue to evolve.
Privacy is subject to other considerations, subject to national interest, subject to revenue considerations. The main thing is, the crux of the matter is, the restriction must not be excessive.
377, if somebody does it in his bedroom, nobody will know about it. But any public display of homosexuality or lesbianism will be struck down.
The LGBTQ community, which has been long fighting for the decriminalization of Section 377, believes the verdict gives them fresh hope.
I think it's a matter of time, to be very honest, that at last there'll be the independence and freedom for gay men and the LGBTI community.
But caught on the back foot, the centre has refused to comment on the status of Section 377 for now.
Today is a very important day to talk about the poor, underprivileged and the right of privacy with regard to them. On that issue, we'll revert to at some time in future.
But the burning question stays, will India's Rainbow Brigade finally get their right to privacy? Mirror Now report.
Good evening, viewers. You're watching the Urban Debate on Mirror Now. Tonight is not a night for shrill screaming. Tonight is a night for celebration. The Supreme Court, 9-judge bench, has unanimously agreed that we have a fundamental right to privacy. There are many aspects to this fundamental right to privacy. It deals with a lot of things that we've brought up on this channel in the past. Things like Aadhaar. Why are we being asked to link it to so many different parts of our lives, whether it's our banks, our IT returns, or our phone records? Will the government be able to do that in the future? But right now, we need to focus on something far more compelling. Section 377. Section 377 fundamentally outlaws or makes illegal homosexuality in our country, any sort of unnatural sex. But in its order, assuring us the right to privacy, the Supreme Court has mentioned 377 and talked about how it is fundamentally against the right to privacy. It has reserved the decision on whether or not 377 is constitutional for the 5-judge bench. But the battle seems now so much closer to end. We might, in fact, very soon see the dastardly 377 crushed completely by our newfound fundamental right to privacy. I want to understand what you think. We're going to spend the next half hour to an hour understanding what the right to privacy means for those in the LGBT community and their right to dignity and their right to privacy. You can join us either by calling onto the phone line that's at the bottom of your screen or by typing invol.in on the browser of your phone and leaving us either a message or a question. I have a fantastic panel of guests, a very learned panel of guests this evening, and I'm very happy to introduce to you Mr. Anand Grover, Senior Advocate with the Supreme Court, Kailash Vasudev, Senior Advocate with the Supreme Court, Vishwajit Bhattacharya, former Additional Solicitor General, Prasanna S is a Delhi-based lawyer with the Supreme Court who does not have an Aadhaar card, Aman Sinha is the spokesperson for the BJP, Dhruv Rathi is a social activist and a YouTuber and a very clear voice among young India. And Harish Iyer is an LGBTQ rights activist. I welcome all of you gentlemen to the show and I thank you for your time. It is a wonderful, wonderful opportunity to be having this conversation. I mean, despite the fact that we've spent so many months talking about whether or not the right to privacy is actually a fundamental right, now we know for sure. But I want to focus specifically on the rights of the LGBTQ community. And I'm going to start with Mr. Anand Grover. Mr. Grover, obviously it's a big day, but specifically, yes, what do you think this means for the LGBT community?
Well, you know, the you have to understand the background of this case. The government during the Aadhaar case actually contested whether in India the courts have laid down that there is a fundamental right to privacy. Today I hear the ministers of the government contesting that they never said it. But in fact, because they contested it, the Supreme Court was forced to and constrained to set up a 9-judge bench. And they did that. And the government argued that there is no fundamental right to privacy, and the judgments that they relied on or they wanted to contest were the two judgments of MP Sharma and Kadak Singh. And ultimately, the Supreme Court today has said that the judgments in MP Sharma and Kadak Singh, which laid the wrong law, has been overruled, and there is a fundamental right to privacy in the Indian Constitution. And it is not only in Article 21, which is a procedure established by law. It's not also only in the fundamental freedoms in what is known as Article 19, but all the fundamental rights. So it can be found everywhere and anywhere. Now, it has very important implications in the judgment of the Supreme Court on 377. You may recall that we had won the case in the Delhi High Court. And the Delhi High Court has said, amongst other things, that privacy is one of the things which is violated. In the Supreme Court, the judgment, which was unfortunately not well written and did not consider the issues properly, did not look at the privacy issue properly. And that is the subject matter of comment by the Supreme Court today. The Supreme Court today has said that in the Kaushal judgment, privacy has not been looked at in the proper perspective. So, having this judgment will give us another tool to attack Kaushal in the curative petition. So in my view, as I said earlier, and you apparently relayed it on your channel, it's now a matter of time that this section will actually go, and the genuine freedom for all citizens and persons in India, which the British took away by the Indian Penal Code in 1871, will be restored, hopefully, as soon as possible. So the implications are very important for the whole of the LGBTI community, but not only the LGBTI community. Even people who are not LGBTI community want this to go, because we don't want to see our brethren and sisters and transgender people to be bonded with this kind of sexual bondage, where you have to actually say what you are and you're not allowed to do what you actually, your nature decides that you should do. So I think it's very, very historic, and I'm very glad that the Supreme Court has done it, and it has done it in an emphatic manner. So out of the 9 judges, one judgment of 4 judges and another judgment of 2 judges have actually referred to this and referred to the flaws in the Kaushal judgment. So I think it's a great stepping stone to the ultimate victory which has to come for the LGBTI communities.
All right, let me also bring in Kailash Vasudev. Kailash Vasudev, Mr. Anand Grover said that very articulately, that it is a great judgment and it will bring in a lot of freedom. And you and I have spoken about this so many times on this very show, the fact that whether it came to Aadhaar or it came to the kind of surveillance power it gave the government and to Section 377, there was a lot of overstepping. This would all stop now, won't it?
See, there is... In every bit of law which has been framed, there has been good reason in the past. If you look at the whole gamut of sections starting from 353, 54 onwards, It pertains to sex by force. That means if you are compelling somebody into a coitus, if I may use the word, or sodomizing somebody, it is deemed to be an offense. What the Supreme Court has now sought to clarify is things done voluntarily do not come within the ambit or the gamut of the 377 provisions per se. The LGBT community, many people who are not openly, who are closeted, happy, they would be indeed very delighted because it protects their rights to live life as they want, because it is recognized now as a constitutional right. If I may read out that light, it says they inherit in the right to life. That is what the Supreme Court says. I have a bit of a cross question on the other side, because we are all responsible citizens and we must also look at what happens around here. We have a situation where ladies, girls, women, children are used as tools at the hands of people who exploit them for different purposes, whether it is a rape, whether it is sodomy, whether it is non-consensual sex. Now, these kind of things have also to be addressed. Have a right, correct, you're justified. An inherent right, justified, no dispute. That is strictly within the confines of the privacy domain as discussed by the Supreme Court. What happens in public? When it comes into the public domain, we have to think, we have to protect children, we have to protect ladies, we have to protect anything which is beyond consensual sex. Do you still strike down 377? Or do you modify it or mold the positions because they give you a protection against forceful exploitation? This is the area which will now have to be addressed. The Supreme Court judgment is a superb piece of writing after many years. It has, for the first time, in my view, after the 1950s and 60s, settled down a position which everybody has been wanting, freedom. Because Swaraj is our birth call, our protection from everything. Every now and then you are seeing news channels, data is being sold, passed on, considerations, fiscal realms. That is not the intent of privacy. That is not the intent of government. But if it is, it has to be curbed. If there is an exploitation of a situation, it has to be curbed. Because that person then has a right which is of their own. This has now opened up a huge debate and a fascinating one insofar as all of us are concerned. That's what my view is.
Well, that's a brilliant view. And I just want to play this out. We spoke with Subramanian Swamy, who is an MP, with the BJP, and these were his views about the LGBT community, which is why we decided to have this debate. We spoke to him earlier today. Listen into what he had to say.
No. 377, if somebody does it in his bedroom, nobody will know about it. But any public display of homosexuality or lesbianism will be struck down. And in fact would be part of 377, because it's a genetic flaw according to us and it cannot be celebrated. We will not allow a public demonstration of kissing and holding hands and getting married and so on. The section 377 will not be affected at all, and the reasonable restrictions on its lack of public display would be a reasonable restriction.
A very diverse opinion from the one that Kailash Vasudev just gave us. We will not accept public displays of holding hands, kissing or getting married because we consider it a genetic flaw. Kailash Vasudev, this is not what you were talking about, but this is the bigoted view that we have to deal with. Yes.
No, please understand, my view is a bit different. You are entitled to live your life wherever you want, however you want. Today, unfortunately, we've come into the situation of having groups which say boys and girls holding hands in parks should be admonished and so on and so forth. This is our moral thinking at a certain point of time. But I still raise the question, what about compelling somebody or forcefully sodomizing a person? Will you still bring that within the LGBT domain? Would you not give that person protection? Four-year-old, five-year-old children.
Doesn't that get covered by POCSO?
Won't you give them protections?
Doesn't that get covered by POCSO?
My question, big pardon?
Doesn't that get covered by POCSO, the prevention of sexual offences against children?
I didn't get it.
Can I interrupt?
Yes, it does. But you see, the IPC is the model law. It considers everything.
All right.
Love to hear you, Mr. Grover.
Mr. Grover, go ahead.
Well, you know, as far as children are concerned, there is a special law. But so far, yeah, for children, the Prevention of Sexual Offences Act against children. So those cases are covered. Correct. Where any kind of no, because there is no question of consent with the child. Can I finish, please? So if a child is involved,
Anand, I go one step further. For children, there is a law. One second, please.
It is not covered in rape.
No, one second. I'm going one step further.
Can I please finish?
Please finish? Well, what happens if a person over 20
Can
is kidnapped
first,
and sodomized?
Please, let me finish. I didn't interrupt you. Can please, that is an offence.
Please go ahead, Mr. Grover.
It's got nothing to do with 377 now.
Go ahead,
it is carved out of... Yeah, see, 377 now, after the amendment to 375, only covers males having sex with males who are adults, not children. That is covered by a separate law. And if it is with a woman, it is covered under 375. But if the woman consents to it, there is no question of rape. That is why there is a difference now between a man and a man having sex with each other, which is consensual, and a man and a woman. If it's a man and a woman, earlier it was an offense. Today it is no longer an offense under 375. That is the argument in our case in the curative petition. So you have two standards. Now, a heterosexual anal sex would be punished under 375 if it is non-consensual. If it's consensual, it won't be punished. But 377, if it is consensual, it will still be punished. Our argument is that if it is in the privacy of somebody's home and it is consensual, it cannot be penalized. And that is the logic of today's judgment.
Right.
Children are separately covered. Yeah. There's no question of 377 now being applicable under 377. Please get your law right.
Right. Okay, I want to open this panel up right now for all of our panelists, and also for our viewers at home. I want you to ask yourself a simple question. Tomorrow, if a younger sibling or your child walks up to you and tells you that they are gay, what will your reaction be? Do you not want the country to assure all of these citizens, whether there are siblings or children or not, don't they deserve the same rights that you and I have? I want to bring in Aman Sinha, spokesperson of the BJP. Mr. Sinha, the law minister today did not answer questions about Section 377. He said we'll decide about that later. Subramanian Swamy, speaking purely on his own behalf as a member of parliament, says he sees it as a genetic flaw that should not be celebrated. I want to understand, what is the stand right now of the BJP and what is the stand of the central government on 377?
Good evening, Faye. In fact, I was told that this would be a debate on the right to privacy judgment, which was pronounced by the Supreme Court today, not on 377. But anyhow, as far as the issue of Section 377 is concerned, I believe Supreme Court is seized of the matter and they would take an appropriate view on that. I do not wish to comment anything as such. But with respect to the right to privacy judgment, I can only say that whatever has been the government's consistent stand right from, you know, when the Aadhaar bill was introduced on floor of the House last year, where Finance Minister Mr. Arun Jaitley clearly and categorically stated that right to privacy is a part of Article 21 of the Constitution and is an inherent part of right to life as enshrined in Article 21. Obviously, since no fundamental right is absolute and all the fundamental rights are, they can have reasonable restrictions imposed upon them. So therefore, right to privacy can also be regulated by the government or by a legislative enactment, and there could be reasonable restrictions. And this is what the government argument was. I believe the judgment is broadly along those lines, and we welcome this judgment.
Well, I just want to remind you that, while you would say that the AG didn't say privacy isn't, a fundamental right, there were submissions, written submissions, to the Supreme Court, saying privacy is not a fundamental right, privacy should not be elevated to a fundamental right. And even the state of Maharashtra went as far as saying that there would be, claims put out, or there will be cases that unnecessary litigation will pop up if you actually make this a fundamental right. So the government's stand was fairly clear until this morning, Mr. Sinha. And I want to bring in our other panelists as well.
Yeah, Faye, may I just interrupt?
Yes.
No, may I just respond, actually?
Faye, may I interrupt?
One at a time, Mr. Grover first.
The government stand has changed today.
Yes.
Yeah, the government stand has suddenly changed today. It was only because the government was insisting that there was no fundamental right to privacy, that the three judge bench,
let me assure you that it was your case before the court. We spent
2 weeks because the government insisted. Don't now backtrack. You insisted as the government in the court that no, there is no fundamental right to privacy. The matter was referred to 5 judges. Again, you insisted through your attorney general. Throughout, you have maintained in the court that, and through the attorney general, Mr. Rothgi and Mr. Venugopal, that there is no fundamental right to privacy. In fact, the judge, the Chief Justice, asked Mr. Venugopal, are you insisting? And he said, if you're not, we are closing the case. The government insisted that there is no right. And all the written submissions on part of the government, Mr. Venugopal, Mr. Tushar Mehta, Mr. Argo Zain Gupta, Gopal Shankar Narayan, all of them clearly say there is no right to privacy in the Indian Constitution. Please at least be honest.
Right. All right. Mr. Sinha, respond. And then I can bring in the rest of my panel. Mr. Sinha.
Yes. Please allow me to respond.
Yes.
Don't be a liar.
All right. Mr. Sinha will respond now.
There are two Constitution Bench judgments. There were two Constitution Bench judgments which were holding the field as far as this issue was concerned, where the Supreme Court had earlier come to a conclusion that right to privacy is not a fundamental right. And that was the legal position which was stated by the government in court. And as long as those judgments were prevailing, there was no other legal position which existed. They were holding the field. So I'm not going into details of that, but I am only clearly in course of argument,
but
several arguments.
That's not the stand you took during triple
talaq. And one is entitled to evolve, his arguments.
Please, you know, everybody should be honest. Finance Minister Anand Jethi himself stated that right to privacy is enshrined under Article 21. You are being dishonest.
Right. Let me bring in the other members of the panel. Vishwajit Bhattacharya, former Additional General Solicitor of India.
Do not accuse others being dishonest.
All right.
Everybody can accuse anybody else of being dishonest.
All right, gentlemen. Right. I have to bring in the other members of my panel as well. Mr. Bhattacharya.
May I just say I am somewhat amused that Mr. Aman Sinha is stating that we had argued this in Parliament. The matter is going on in Supreme Court, and Mr. Anand Grover is absolutely correct.
It's a matter of record.
You see, the question is that government fought tooth
and
nail.
It's a matter of record.
Mr. Sinha, you are my good friend. I didn't interrupt you. Now, therefore, I think one fundamental point which we all are missing. This I say with the greatest of respect to all concerned, including Dr. Swami. You see, as far as IPC 377 is concerned, now, Justice Sanjay calls observations. Supporting Justice Dhananjay Chandrachur's judgment today, writing on behalf of Honorable Chief Justice of India, Honorable Justice Abdul Nazir, and Honorable Justice R.K. Agarwala, they have categorically stated that the NARS Foundation judgment of Delhi High Court was a correct proposition of law. So, therefore, the criminality aspect under IPC 377, in my view, it goes. I mean, this is my view. You see, the law declared by a 9-judge bench of the Supreme Court is binding on the entire country. Not only it is binding on the judiciary. Now, you see, in the doctrine of stare decisis, where the law declared by Supreme Court under 141, whether it is binding on Supreme Court or not, that can be argued and debated. But a law declared by a 9-judge Supreme Court bench will surely be binding on law which is going to be declared by any Supreme Court future judgment which a lesser number of judges. This is a basic judicial discipline.
Okay. I want to begin, Harish Iyer.
Read the judgment today, it very, very, very clearly and categorically, the criminality of 377 IPC has been knocked out.
Yes, it has. Yes.
So now it is just a question of formal pronouncement of the verdict the Supreme Court. View of what kind of arguments take place.
You agree it's a matter of time then? You agree it's a matter of time? Harish Iyer, LGBTQ rights activist. Long, hard battle, hard-fought battle, Harish. But it does seem, and if we actually look into it, the things that have been said, and it's such a beautifully drafted order, things like the chilling effect that this has from the grave danger of unhindered fulfillment of one's sexual orientation as an element of privacy and dignity, and I love the use of the word dignity, this could restore dignity to an entire community in India.
Absolutely. I mean, we have long suffered. There have been a lot of extortion cases. There have been a lot of cases where the police was hand in hand in the extortion. So Section 377 not only invades in the privacy of people, but it also leads to a lot of other crimes. What two adults do in private and with consent should be left to those two adults. And this is something that's very basic. This is not something that we need to break our heads on. And I'm really amazed by Mr. Sinha not taking a stand, or BJP Ravi Shankar Prasad saying that we'll speak about this later. What is there to speak about later? I mean, isn't this the most basic thing? We have voted you to power. Would you completely forget us? Would you completely negate us? Would you silence us, and would you not speak about us? Are we invisible? I am here, a gay man standing in front of you. You can see me in your screens. Am I the least common denominator, and my rights not important? Can't Ravi Shankar Prasad even address this issue? Are we that bad? Do you think the rights of minorities are that unimportant that you can't even address us? And you wouldn't stand up against Subramaniam Swamy, who makes this claim that homosexuality is illegal and homosexuality is a disease. You wouldn't stand up against him? Isn't that very basic? Haven't you read science? The American Psychiatric Association has delisted homosexuality from the list of mental disorders. The Indian Psychiatric Association has delisted it from the list of mental disorders. So wouldn't you just read science, forget everything
else? Arguments before the Supreme Court, which is seized of this matter.
That's not a good argument. I am asking you one basic thing.
Mr. Aman Sinha, with all due respect, when we were talking about triple talaq, the government made repeated and very clear public statements about your stand on triple talaq while the Supreme Court was seized of the matter. Why is there a double standard with this particular case?
No, there are no double standards. Government is entitled to its view. And the views are formulated after, incorporating large number of views of several stakeholders. And the government will present it before the Supreme Court at the appropriate time. As I was mentioning to you, Faye, I was not told that this is a debate on Section 377. And as far as I understand, the Supreme Court is already seized of the matter. And let them consider all aspects and pronounce on this. We have no
so then in that case, I have one more question for you, Aman Sinha, in connection with the fundamental right to privacy. And Dhruv Rathi, I'm going to come to you immediately after this. Aman Sinha, the Maharashtra government submitted to the Supreme Court that it wanted to be able to empower its law enforcement agencies to walk into people's homes and check if we have beef in our refrigerators, because it believed that the Bombay High Court had misread the right to privacy. What is your response to that today?
Right.
Faye, your audio is not very clear, so I could not gather exactly which provision you are referring to, but I can only tell you that if any statutory enactment which on touchstone of, you know, fundamental right is violative of any provision of Part 3 of the Constitution, then it would not sustain. So if this is before court of law, the court will adjudicate on this. But as far as we are concerned, we are very clear that right to privacy is a part of fundamental right. It's an integral part of right to life. And like any other fundamental right, it's not going to be absolute right. This is what the judgment itself records in its conclusion. And therefore, reasonable restrictions could be imposed. That also, this particular judgment today has enunciated very clearly that, you know, in the interest of national security, safety, etc., and several other, you know, factors they have incorporated, the reasonable restrictions could be imposed. So government will consider it at the appropriate time. If any law does not come to that standard or is violative of any provision in Part 3 of the Constitution, then courts will pronounce them void and illegal. So there is no any confusion on that account.
Dhruv Rathi, social rights activist and YouTuber. Dhruv Rathi, go ahead.
Yeah. I think it's funny when he says, Mr. Sinha says that government has had a consistent stand until now, because I have this clipping from the newspaper just a few months ago. Clearly says that citizens don't have absolute right over their bodies. This clearly proves that Mr. Sinha is lying here when he says the government statement has not changed. It's a
no, no, please don't go by this. Every courtroom banter, you cannot imagine it as a divine truth. You must understand, these newspaper clippings are not going to get you anywhere. May I respond now?
No, Dhruv, are you done making your point?
Hey, I wish to respond. No, what are these blanket sweeping judgments passed here without even, you know, ascertaining what has happened in court? If some courtroom banter is made and something comes up in the newspaper, my friend here, without even, you know, appreciating in what context it might have been said, starts saying that other people are lying. Have you even bothered to check up what the judgment is about? Have you read the judgment? And you are showing newspaper clippings as if they are the pious divine truth emanating from divine almighty. What is the point that you are making? Please, you must understand the context in which certain things are said. This was a courtroom banter, and therefore, you know, it was misreported in this manner.
Oh, okay. It was misreported in every newspaper, and there were video recordings of BJP spokespersons saying that it is not an absolute.
It might be.
I also want to bring in Prasanna S.
Who are you to say that somebody is lying without any basis, without knowing anything, based on some newspaper clipping?
No, but I just want to point out that Dhruv is reacting to the front page of a national newspaper, and the front page of several national newspapers that day carried the same headline. So as a citizen whose source of information...
It's not a part of the judgment.
It's not a part of the judgment. All right. Mr. Grover, go ahead, and then Prasanna. Mr. Grover?
No, Faye, may I interrupt?
No, not at all.
No, my good friend Aman Sinha is actually using his legal prowess, if I may say so, to overawe an ordinary person who doesn't know the legal ramifications. But Aman, let's be very clear.
No question at all.
The government has
there
changed
its stance. There are several eminent legal luminaries who are my close friends.
Let me finish. I have a lot of respect for you, Aman. Please let me finish. I mean, let me say, the government, unfortunately, as I see it, went on a stand clearly, not only reported in the newspapers, but also throughout the proceedings in the court, which are part of their written submissions, to say fundamental right to privacy doesn't exist. They based their judgment, submissions on two judgments, which have been specifically overruled. Now, you can argue that if we thought that was the rule of the law at that time, which I contest. We said that latter judgments actually... But anyway, the point is, the government had a stand. Today, it has changed. We welcome it if they have changed it. But let's not go on this thing about, you know, we always said it. But that's not correct. Aman, let's be honest about it. And let's go on. I think it's a good stand that the government is now changed, which is a welcome stand. And this will be tested out in other cases like Aadhaar.
That was the, rather no, as than you were going saying, back Anandi, on that was the legal position that it existed. they because were if judgments you look at the of larger bench and submissions, Aman, so.
Aman, if you return, read.
This is interesting because a lot of these submissions that were made as part of court records are in written. A lot of the submissions were written records as part of court records, and they can be accessed. So
they're all available on the... the website.
They're all available on the website. So it's actually quite futile to say that we didn't say something that's now available in writing. But I want to bring in Prasanna S. Prasanna S is a very...
Let's get on now.
Yeah, it's absolutely. We should just move on from it. Prasanna is the Delhi-based lawyer who does not have an Aadhaar card.
What is also available is the judgment.
Yes. Prasanna? Prasanna does not have an Aadhaar card. Prasanna, go ahead.
Judgment doesn't. Judgment is...
Many,
may I be excused now because I have...
many congratulations to you all and all your viewers. Today is a festival for our Indian constitution.
Go ahead, Prasanna.
Right. So, this is at the beginning of your program, Faye, you mentioned that this is a new found right. I'd want to nitpick on that. It is not a new found right. This is a right that Indians have cherished for at least 40 years, if not more. There is an unbroken line of decisions that have actually held that privacy is a fundamental right.
From 1975.
From 1975 and possibly from 1963, even the majority judgment in Khadak Singh, even though it says there is no fundamental right to privacy, it actually...
Correct.
It strikes down a regulation on the very same ground.
Prasanna, if you'll allow me to interrupt you for just one second, please. Prasanna, I apologize.
Chain of decisions. Right. We've enjoyed this right for a long time.
Prasanna, I apologize. I'm going to interrupt you for just a second. And you know, Mr. Sinha was just saying you should read the judgment. If you know, it only holds if it's in the judgment. In the judgment, Mr. Sinha, it says that the Attorney General had submitted that privacy is an elitist construct. And the judgment goes on to say this submission betrays a misunderstanding of the constitutional position. So, if you read the judgment, Mr. Sinha, there are several references to the government's stand.
Can I ask you to read?
I have read it.
Can I ask you to read paragraph 113 also?
Right. I'll have to look for it. Prasanna can go ahead and finish his point, and then I'll just fish out paragraph 113 for you.
This question of what was the government stand, etc., is fairly clear now. This was among the most followed hearings, one of the first live tweeted hearings, if I may say so, right? And all the court records are out there. So let me point to Mr. Sinha. So para 16 and 17, pages 11 and 12 of Attorney General's written submissions to the court clearly say that it is not a fundamental right. In fact, see, the Supreme Court does not make any academic suggestions, does not give academic opinions. There was definitely a dispute. And what was that dispute? The dispute was whether or not there was a fundamental right to privacy. So let's move on from that point. There are two other points that I wanted to make, Faye. So, we've had an unbroken line of decisions. For some reason, it is in this case that the government chose to contest this notion whether or not it's a fundamental right to privacy for reasons best known to them. It is it's very fortunate that we've had a 9-judge bench, which is a rarity in Indian Supreme Court's history, and even rare is a 9-judge bench speaking in one voice, reaffirming the proposition of privacy as a fundamental right. Right, and it has far-reaching implications, not just for the Aadhaar case. For the Aadhaar case, it certainly has a far-reaching implication. For other cases, for instance, as you mentioned, 377 case. And let me make a quick point on what is it about this the section 377 that is important in this judgment. There was a legal reasoning given to uphold 377 in Suresh Kaushal's case. That is whether a minuscule minority may get affected, etc., etc. All of that legal reasoning has been overruled. Virtually, the Delhi High Court judgment, a very erudite Delhi High Court judgment that decriminalized consensual sex, has now been restored. And as Mr. Grover said, it's only a matter of time before, if the curative is allowed, it's only a matter of time before Section 377 continues to be decriminalized. And just one other quick point that I wanted to make, especially in light of Dr. Swami's argument that public display of affection by by LGBT will not be tolerated, etc., etc. Even 377 did not criminalize public display of affection. And certainly after this judgment, which has liberally defined privacy and has narrowly defined conditions under which privacy may be restricted, even public display of affection, right? So privacy is not only about secrecy, you being in a room, etc., etc. It is about the person being in control as to how public he wants to be, how private he wants to be. That is privacy. So in which case, public display of affection by an LGBT community member will certainly have to be tolerated, and it cannot be criminalized, and no way, if there is a law that criminalizes that, it will be struck down on the basis that it is a violation of privacy as well as violation of non-discrimination laws.
I mean, if I may just add to what my friend says,
yes,
public display of love and affection cutting across any two human beings or souls will invite the same treatment under the law.
Yes.
So you can't distinguish between a gay and a homosexual or a lesbian or a male or a female or a transgender.
Let me also point out to you, Mr. Bhattacharya, public display of affection in our country between any two people invites the same sort of reaction from the moral police. They react in the same manner whether the couple is heterosexual or homosexual or anybody else. The moral police likes to tell everybody what to do.
You see, moral police, no, no, you see the question is, suppose you are sitting in a park, suppose you are holding hand, which law is it violating?
Yes.
Suppose two souls, I will not even say male, female, it may be male, female, transgender, homosexual, lesbian, LGBT, whatever it is. You are holding hands, sitting in, which law is it violating?
Absolutely.
And you know, as far as this criminality is concerned, are we assuming that at birth, can somebody be born a born criminal? The moment the child is born out of the mother's womb, and the sexual inclination makes the child a sort of criminal. So therefore,
if Subramanian Swami is arguing that it is a genetic flaw, then it is a genetic flaw that is nobody's fault. And if it's a genetic flaw, then that person should be allowed to live with dignity, like you would allow anybody else to live with dignity. Yes.
The different human beings have different inclinations.
All right.
Now,
all right.
With that inclinations, you will invite criminal action.
Absolutely.
Yeah. It's
anyone who wants to make a point now, just raise your hand. I just want to bring in one caller. Your Rishi is on the phone line from Noida. Our phone lines are open. Rishi, go ahead.
Hey, Faye, and congratulations to each and every panelist on this, historic ruling of Supreme Court.
Yes.
I would like to ask my question to Mr. Shah. As a 16-year-old openly gay young boy who is about to be adult in 2 years and eligible to vote, it really scares me to the core what comments are coming from Subramaniam Swamy and what the actions are BJP taking against BJP-led government is taking against LGBT community. In 2016, a bill was proposed in which LGBT people were banned from, though I really don't know if it's being discussed in parliament or not, but they were banned from adopting children. And there was a news about LGBT people are being prevented from donating blood. So on one hand, the NDA-led government says that we are changing our mindset and all that stuff. But on the other hand, the actions don't go well. So I would just like to ask, why is there so much hypocrisy? Why can't you just straightforward say that, straightforward accept the fact that until and unless you include LGBT people in your development agenda, there will be no sabka saath, sabka vikas.
All right, Rishi. For a young man of 16, I want to applaud you for making that phone call. That was a very brave thing to do. That's Mr. Sinha, I believe that question was directed to you. Do you want to answer that?
Well, Faye, you know, people are entitled to their opinion, and we welcome that people, you know, freely voice their opinion. As far as this issue is concerned, since, you know, this has gone through several stages of, judicial scrutiny, and it is right at its, end as a curative, perhaps Supreme Court is considering it. So therefore, let us await the judgment. I do not wish to comment any further on that. We will abide by whatever Supreme Court says. And Faye, since I have another commitment. If I can seek your leave to go, you know, I would be very glad, Faye.
Actually, Mr. Sinha, I wanted to know, do you have a personal opinion on the LGBT community?
No, there is no personal opinion that we wish as we express as spokesperson. But obviously, you know, they are entitled to, you know, voice their opinion. And we have our, you know, empathy, support for them. But, you know, as far as the issue is concerned, let the issue be decided by the Supreme Court. Supreme Court is seized of the matter. So I do not feel that, you know, there is any
all
hurry.
Right. So there's just one more thing that I want you to respond to before you leave, before I let you go. If we could just play out what Kapil Sibal said to us today, and then this is his response to Mirror Now. I just want your reaction before you leave for your next appointment. Could we play out, Mr. Sibal, please?
Very saddened by the fact that an individual who holds the position of a law minister can say something that happened in court, which is entirely contrary to what he says in public. Because I have the written submissions of the Attorney General and say that the claim to privacy, which would destroy or erode this basic foundation of the Constitution, can never be elevated to the status of a fundamental right. And these are his written submissions. I have the judgment of the court, page after page.
Yes,
that judgment reflects that the Attorney General for India argued that privacy is not a fundamental right. So I think that at least the minimum expected of the law minister was to read the judgment before making a public statement in a press conference.
Mr. Aman Sinha, do you want to respond to that?
That is what I was saying, Faye. What law minister was saying was absolutely correct. That was the considered stand of the government while presenting the Aadhaar bill on floor of the house. Statement was made that we consider right to privacy as an integral part of Article 21, which is right to life. And therefore, that is what law minister said. Now, thereafter, what has happened is that since there were two constitution bench judgments of, which were holding field on this account, therefore, we said that this is what the rule of law is as on date. And, therefore, it was being defended. But we have no difficulty at all. You know, the issue is not that, you know, whether a fundamental right or not. The point was that, you know, obviously, if privacy is an integral part of right to life, nobody, you know, can deny that. However, you know, any fundamental right is subject to reasonable restriction and regulation. And that was the only concern of government. You know, government's concern was not that it shouldn't be a fundamental right. Government's only concern was that our large welfare social schemes, which are, you know, which have targeted delivery, or there are, you know, several issues pertaining to, you know, national security and other, you know, several factors which were very well enunciated in the judgment itself. There should not be, you know, any difficulty on those accounts, or, you know, those schemes which are for, you know, general common good, or they are there in interest.
I assume you're referring to the Aadhaar. I assume you're referring to the Aadhaar scheme, which is why we began this conversation to begin with. Now, the government was in a hurry to link the Aadhaar card, the Aadhaar numbers to our PAN cards before the filing of tax returns for this year. A lot of that is still in process, which is why the entire question of privacy came into play. Now, linking Aadhaar and IT returns have absolutely no impact whatsoever on either national security or on the delivery of subsidy to individuals. It does not fall into the category of exceptions. Will that have to now stop? Mr. Aman Sinha, is the government going to have to rethink that move?
As far as Aadhaar scheme is concerned, Faye, it is going on uninterrupted. But you're right, the judgment which was pronounced today, there is a separate bench which is considering the issue with respect to, you know, legality and all these questions pertaining to Aadhaar scheme. And, you know, they will be tested on touchstone of today's judgment which has come. So let the Supreme Court pronounce on that. But as far as we are concerned, the Aadhaar scheme has not been, you know, there has been no adverse observation against the Aadhaar scheme as far as today's judgment is concerned. And there is another bench which is seized of the matter. Let them pronounce it. But there is no interruption or any kind of impediment with respect to Aadhaar or any of the large social welfare schemes of this government.
Prasanna?
Thank you.
Yeah, after today's judgment, the Aadhaar scheme in its current form may not be able to continue. The right of privacy has been very liberally interpreted by this judgment, and also the conditions under which such a right can be restricted is also been very narrowly put. Right? Not only should there be a law, that law should also have legitimate aims, and the restriction should also be proportionate to the benefit that it seeks to give. In which case, a general purpose identity platform in which that proportionality test can never be applied will cannot stand in view of today's judgment, and therefore that Aadhaar will have to be rethought.
Aadhaar
will perhaps have to go.
The basic structure of Aadhaar now will have to
fall in line with this judgment.
The very idea of a general purpose identity platform now is of suspect constitutionality.
All right, so the basic idea of Aadhaar right now is going to have to be taken back to the drawing board completely. Mr. Aman Sinha, spokesperson of the BJP, has left the conversation, but we are going to continue to take phone calls. If any of our panelists want to make a point, please raise your hand and let me know. Bobby of Chhattisgarh on the phone line right now. Bobby, go ahead.
I want to make a point.
All right, Mr. Vasudev, go ahead.
Yes. See, the position is this. This judgment today has given you rights and cemented rights which we thought of, but now they have come by way of law. In the recent past, if you notice, the Supreme Court has done humongous service to all of us. Whether a triple talaq case, whether it is a present judgment which is of a very, very wide-reaching effect. All of us who cherish our freedoms have been protected. We have always said that our items like Aadhaar, unique identity, etc., which are now freely available. As a matter of fact, this evening there was a channel in which there was a particular gentleman being interviewed who said, for 10 paisa, I'll give you all the information which you want. Now, these are areas which have suddenly come up and come to a position where government has to rethink its entire systems. We as citizens were aware of our rights, which have very well been upheld by the Supreme Court. We discuss 377, you've discussed other matters which come, but please understand that of late, the Supreme Court has been your only savior in many a matter. Whether it is your rights into the privacy, whether it is your rights for your social norms, whether it is the positions which you go through in your everyday life. Now, if that is the position, it is time that all of us got together, stopped moral policing, came down to a situation where we accepted each other as we stand and as we are, and the government also accepted us as citizens, not as pieces of tax collection revenues. We are not items. We are human beings entitled to our rights. And that is what the court has done.
That's really well said. Dhruv Rathi, obviously there's been a flip-flop up till now. And I love what Mr. Vasudev said, that we're people, we're individuals, we're not items of tax collection.
Yeah. I would like to add a point here that what remains to be seen is...
And we are not numbers. We are not mere numbers.
Yes, Dhruv,
what remains to be seen is how the government and the country and the police responds to the Supreme Court's judgment. Because last time I remember, 2 years ago in 2015, the Supreme Court struck down the IT Act, Section 66A. But despite doing that, 1 year later, there were so thousands of arrests made regarding that outdated law. So it will still remain to be seen how it's implemented and if government actually listens to the Supreme Court's judgment or not.
Well, I'm just going to ask this for clarity as well, and I'll ask this question of Vishwajit Bhattacharya. Mr. Bhattacharya, what this order does is assure us that we have a fundamental right to privacy. Now going forward, every law that is written, every rule that is made will have to be made keeping in mind the fact that we have a fundamental right to privacy. It will have to be written around our fundamental right. And all of the rules that have been made in the past that we're still following will possibly be challenged at this point. Things like, for example, the medical termination of pregnancy that is intrusive to a woman's choice of whether or not she can have an abortion. Things like marital rape. Things like, the Aadhaar Act, the UADI Act, all of these things, and most importantly, Section 377, all of these things are going to come back into question, perhaps like Mr. Vasudev said, in the Supreme Court, as litigation is going to increase, Mr. Bhattacharya. The Supreme Court is going to have a job on its hands.
Not
well,
really.
I do you not see, really the think so, for the simple...
has already been done by this nightmare judgment?
For the simple reason that, you know, the law declared by the Supreme Court will have a retrospective effect. So, therefore, a lot of people will settle the issues, they will restrain themselves, there will be some moral pressure on everyone to not, you know, cross beyond the limits of what has been today propounded by the Supreme Court. So, I don't think necessarily litigation will, it will definitely, it will act as a healthy check on the state. Before the state acts on beliefs, views, feelings, suspicions, surmises, conjectures, possibilities, speculation, now that kind of state arbitrariness of state action will have to be restrained. So, therefore, in my view, and there will be a moral pressure all around. I mean, on a sort of lighter vein, may I just say, now if somebody is attempting, suppose some state instrumentality is attempt to enter your house, you will be entitled to put a signpost as a private individual. Trespassers will be prosecuted. So right. Therefore, yeah. it will temper the behavioral pattern of the instrumentalities of the state. And this will be across the length and breadth of the country. The state can surely pounce upon the privacy and personal liberty, but in the certain extreme circumstances like security and integrity of the state, friendly relationship with foreign countries, and all these which are facets of Article 19, even under Article 21, you know, no person shall be deprived of his life or personal liberty except according to procedure established by law. So, if there is some procedure established by law, your privacy can be deprived. It's not that state will be completely remediless, but it will act as a healthy check on the state,
right,
and the harassment to right. any innocent person. Now, I hope we'll win.
See, I just want...
Right, Mr. Vasudev, but how can this be retrospective? The order has not specified that this will be retrospective in any way. Can it have a retrospective
effect? No, it is not retrospective. It is not...
No, that's the law.
No,
law declared by the Supreme Court, unless it specifically states prospective, is always retrospective.
That's a controversial idea. But I wanted to go one step further. See, one more fascinating part of this judgment. They have set aside the judgment of five judges in ADM Jabalpur. ADM Jabalpur said you had no fundamental rights during a national emergency or a state emergency. Justice Khanna dissented. Justice Chandrachud has specifically upheld the views of Justice Khanna. See the beauty of our system. That one man who cherished freedoms and in his judgment wrote a very powerful passage by quoting certain American judgments, said that a future generation or a future time will consider what I have said. Today, it is a great amount of joy to see that Justice Khanna's view has been vindicated and the freedoms have been restored even during an emergency. So, if you have taken away that absolute power of the state to suspend your rights during an emergency, the Supreme Court has done a yeoman service to all of us in big part.
All right. I have run out of time.
They have done us a huge favor.
Yes.
Can I just add? And I would entirely agree with my friend Kailash Vasudev.
Yes.
The junior Honorable Justice Chandrachud has overruled Senior Justice Chandrachud's judgment on ADM Jabalpur.
Right. I have run out of time, gentlemen. Unfortunately, I have to wrap this up here, but we will continue to have conversations about the right to privacy and the impact it will have on our lives. If you as viewers have questions, you can find us on Twitter, on Facebook, and you can reach our phone line. But like I said at the beginning of the show, it is very clear. These nine judges did not mince words when they said very, very clearly that the dignity and privacy of the citizens of India within the LGBT community must be restored. Most of the legal minds on this panel have agreed that it is only a matter of time before the horrid Section 377 is set aside. And that dignity of life and of work is restored to our brothers and sisters within the LGBTQ community. I thank again the Supreme Court for giving us, as citizens of India, above all things, hope. Hope that our country will rise and will grow, and our constitution, like is said in this order, is an evolving, living document that moves with the times. We look forward to a greater, freer day when we all live equally as we should. Thanks for watching.